Good morning and welcome to worship as we gather here at Unionville. We're glad to have you here with us, whether you're joining us in person or joining us online. Today we've got a special treat for you. We have a Wycliffe translator that's with us that will be speaking this morning. Let us turn our hearts to the Lord as we hear our prelude this morning. I invite you to rise. We join together in singing our musical call to worship. How shall we live when we have more than enough? The earth is our teacher, nurturing and tender. Let us worship God, the ground of all being, as we lift our voices together, singing Christ is alive. Thank you. join with me in prayer. Living Word, whose love abides in us, you call us to love in truth and action. Give courage to our hearts so we may love your beloveds. Open our ears to the wisdom of those you send who might otherwise be dismissed. Transform our charity into justice over all the earth. Amen. You may be seated. Our first scripture this morning is from the book of 1 John, chapter 3, verses 16 to 24. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth. This then is how we know that we belong to the truth, and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence. Whenever our hearts condemn us, for God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask because we obey his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he's commanded us. Those who obey his commands live in him, and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. And then from the book of John, chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd who owns the sheep, so when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. Word of God to the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite the choir to come forward to share in the ministry of music. invite the children to come forward for the children's time. Good morning. I've got a question for you. Have you heard about the story about the wolf and the three pigs? Yeah? Yeah, I thought that might be familiar. So we've got a big bad wolf, right? And a big bad wolf comes to the first pig's house. What's the first pig's house made out of?
Straw.
That's right. And what happens? The wolf knocks on the door. Hey, little pig, let me in. And how do they respond? That's right, not by the hair, my chinny chin chin. And then the wolf huffs and puffs and blows the house down. So the little pig runs off to the other little pig's house. And the two of them are in that house. And what's that house made out of? Do you remember? Sticks, that's right. And so the wolf goes up, knocks on the door, and says, oh, little pig, let me in. And what's the wolf get told by the pigs? Yeah, not by the hair, my chinny chin chin. And so he huffs, and he puffs, and the house falls in. And so those two pigs go running over to the third little pig's house. What's the third little pig's house made out of? Bricks, that's right. And the wolf goes up and knocks on the door and says, hey, little pigs, let me in. And what do they say back? Not by the hair, my chinny chin chin. And he huffs and he puffs. And the house doesn't fall in. So then he climbs up onto the roof and he decides he's going to go down the chimney. Well, then he discovers that they got a pot of hot water boiling on the fire in the fireplace. Yow! Yeah. And we hear the three little pigs singing, don't we, at that point? Remember what they sing? Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? The big bad wolf, the big bad wolf. Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? Tra-la-la-la-la. You look like you'd never heard that before. Yeah. You have to get after Mom and Dad to sing the song, too. In fact, there are a lot of stories that are about wolf. We've got Peter and the Wolf is another one. We've got Little Red Riding Hood is this, another story that's about a wolf meeting her in the woods. Let's see. The Boy Who Cried Wolf. And today's story from out of the scriptures that Jesus tells us is also about a wolf. And in that story, he talks about himself being the good shepherd and that he takes good care of his sheep. And that when the wolf comes, if he has a hired hand, the hired hand will run away because the hired hand doesn't care about the sheep versus his safety. And so the wolf will devour the sheep at that point. But he's the good shepherd, and so he'll protect the sheep. And it's a way of Jesus telling the story to remind us that we are the sheep and that Jesus and God care about us and will take care of us. And the wolf is all kinds of bad things that can happen to us, especially from evil. And it's a reminder that he's the good shepherd and that he'll take care of us and that we'll know it's him because we'll recognize his voice. And that we know him, and he knows us, then we'll be able to be protected by the sheep. I was thinking about that, and I thought about my dog. You know, there are some nights that I might get home late enough that Lois has already gone to bed, and the house may be dark. And when I walk in, my dog doesn't attack me, because I speak to him right away, and so he hears my voice, and he recognizes it. And that's the way it is for us, that if we seek to be in relationship with Jesus, Jesus knows our voice, and we know Jesus' voice, and he keeps us safe as a result. Let us pray. God, we give thanks for the many ways in which you keep us safe in each and every day. And we ask your protection. We give thanks that you are our good shepherd and that you take care of us in every way. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And you may go back for children's church if you'd like. And I welcome you to lift your voices in singing Now the Green Blade Rises.
Now the green blade rises from the buried grave.
I want to start out by first giving a little bit of an introduction for our sermon time, partly for online, because we're not going to be leaving the live recording up. We're going to do an edited version that we'll put up after this morning, and that's for the safety of our translator that's with us this morning, and he'll say a little bit more word about that in his message. And so for those of you who may be listening later in the week, we're sorry that you aren't going to be able to hear the whole message this day. But please keep our translator in your prayers as we continue forward. He is married, has a wife and two children. They just had their second child in December, right? November. And so they stayed home today. They're back here on furlough. And so they stayed up home today with the two little ones, a little bit of a handful yet. And so Nick will come and share with us about the ministry that God has called him into and give us a little bit of a view of what he gets to do and what his wife and he get to do as a team in South Asia. We aren't saying the country, again, intentionally for their safety. Nick?
Good morning, church. And I'm honored to be here this morning to share with you some of what we've seen God doing through Bible translation in South Asia. But since you don't know me or my family, really, I'm going to mention just a bit of our story, how we ended up in South Asia in the first place. So my wife, her parents actually do Bible translation as well in Africa, and so she grew up as a missionary kid, and she loved that life, but she didn't plan on following in her parents' footsteps. But when she was in high school, she went on a short-term missions trip to Mexico, and although she would say she was very lukewarm in her faith at that time, God graciously used her to share the gospel with a woman who ended up accepting Christ. And so my wife got to to see this woman's newfound joy as she believed and put her faith in Christ. And so that really propelled her into missions. She wanted to do missions, but she didn't know where. And so she did a short vision trip with some friends who were Bible translators, and through that trip she realized, wow, this is an amazing ministry. I get to be able to leave somebody with God's word. You know, it's his living word. It's going to be transforming people's minds and their hearts even long after I might be gone. And so she was really captured by that vision and wanted to get into Bible translation. So as for me, not much diversity to speak of, no awareness of missions really early on, but I had always enjoyed languages, and I didn't think I could do anything with that. So I actually got my major was computer science, and so I graduated and got a job in software engineering. While I was in Maryland working there, God brought me to a church where I saw God's word being really faithfully preached and really lived out in the small groups and in the lives of everybody at that church. And so it really, even though I had been a Christian for a while, I grew in my love of God's word in a way that I had not up to that point. I got to the point where I couldn't imagine living without it, you know. And God chose that time to put someone in my life to talk to me one day and say, hey, did you know there are, at this time, 1,800 different people groups who do not have a word of God's word in their own language? And that blew my mind. That in this day and age, we could have so many people groups that don't have any of God's word. And so that was a bit of a light bulb moment for me. Well, I like languages. I love God's word. Maybe I could do something about this. There's a huge need. And so I'll skip over some of the details there, but I'll say that within a couple years, I had left my software engineering job and gone on to do the master's in Bible translation, and that's where my wife and I met. We found that the other person had been being led toward this country in South Asia and sort of saw that we were on the same journey there. And long story short, we've been together, married, and serving in South Asia since 2018. In this country right now, this is what's happening in Bible translation. There are only 5 complete Bibles, but there are 36 New Testaments which have been completed. And out of those 36 New Testaments, some of those 9 teams of them have continued on to the Old Testament and are working on that. And as we speak, there are 49 other New Testaments in progress. I mean, that's a huge amount of translation and resources and people and time and work. There's a lot going on in our country in Bible translation. And there are groups of people left who still need to have projects be started for them. Speaking of persecution, in this country, you're allowed to be a Christian, but in most of these societies, if you become a Christian, you're looking at maybe your family never talking to you again, maybe kicking you out of your village, maybe not giving you any help with your farm work, which you need your community to help you with to survive. We have people who we know who their parents have disowned them. You're not my child anymore. Get out of here. You know, we have people who have been threatened with violence and had to leave in the middle of the night or else people will burn their house down. So there's a lot of exclusion from society if you become a Christian in many of these places. The government does not persecute too heavily unless you are openly sharing the gospel. But sort of evangelistic activity is not allowed, anything that endangers somebody else's religion. Our work falls under evangelistic work category, so we have to be really careful not to have anything online about us, which is why Pastor Allen has been so thoughtful to be careful about that stuff for our sakes. One of the highlights of this work that we do is that we get to kind of a front row seat as we see translators, as they work with God's word on a daily basis in translation, they get discipled by his word, and they grow in their faith, or sometimes they aren't even Christians when they start. So we have a few Buddhists who work on these teams. And so they get to encounter Jesus during the translation process. And so one or two of them have become believers during translation, and a couple of them are on that same journey. And so there are a couple other translators who have not yet come fully to Jesus. And so we can be praying for those translators on that journey. We do have prayer slides, but I think we'll just kind of go through them quickly now, and I can talk more about them later. As you think of us in the coming days, if you are a praying person, you could pray for our country, that God would keep moving in the country and drawing many people to himself. He is working. You can pray for the translators, these non-Christians I shared, and some of the new Christians one of whom I shared about as well. And you could pray for our family, too. We have our last big transition coming up here in a month, and we are jumping right into things when we get back with a big 3-week workshop. It'll be very intense. So you could pray for our family as well. And I have a few prayer cards I set out in the back in the hallway there, and be sharing more at the Sunday school afterwards. So thanks so much for listening, and I pray that it's been encouraging and edifying to you.
It's an exciting ministry, an exciting opportunity. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give thanks for your love that you share with us each and every day, but we give thanks even more so for the ways in which you inspire a variety of people to be able to respond to your love, to be able to bring your love to bear, and to let the stories of your life, the stories of how you seek to come to this world, to be among us, to give us life. That the scriptures can be translated so that those who have not heard can hear it in their own language. We give thanks, Lord, for the wisdom that you give to translators to be able to embrace those languages and find the help the teams to find the right words to convey the story, the message, the hope, the life. We so often, Lord, live in our first world bubble, and we don't even begin to realize. We don't think about the lives that get put on the line to bring the Bible to our own languages. Because we grew up with it. We've had it here for a long time, and we forget the Reformation age. We forget the lives that were given, that we can read the Bible today in our own language. And now through others, you give that opportunity to still others in the world. Thank you. We thank you for the many ways in which you touch our lives each and every day. We give thanks for the many blessings that you bestow upon us. We give thanks, Lord, for your presence in the midst of struggles. We think about those who have been dealing with a variety of illnesses. We think about April, about Jenny, Chrissy. We think about the Bud Mead family as they mourn his passing. We think about Amy. We think about Hillary. We pray, Lord, that you continue to bring healing upon all these people. For you know what each of their needs is. We think about those who are awaiting surgery or recovering from surgery. We ask your holy presence. We give thanks, Lord, for the prayers that you've answered in such glorious ways. And we give thanks, Lord, that you know the depths of our hearts and know those prayers that we have not lifted aloud, but we lift to you. We pray for our children and our youth. We pray for our church ministries, especially as we think of the upcoming Vacation Bible School, as we think of the work of Compassionate Ministries, as we come into the last weeks of our kids' club and our youth group. We pray, Lord, that you continue to bless each of these settings, that those who might not fully know your love for them will discover that love in you. We pray for our church family, for our community around us, for our neighbors as we think about those who live next door, those who are across the street, those who are behind, and for those across town that maybe we never have known, let alone those around the world. We pray for our first responders as we think of our firefighters and paramedics and police officers ready to meet the need. We pray for men and women who serve in the military, whether it be in nearby places or faraway places, but especially for those who are in harm's way. We think about those who are living in places that are in the distress of war. We think of those who are living in the midst of disaster. We ask your presence. We pray for our nation, for our president and Congress, for our governor and for our legislature, for our county and local leaders. We ask your blessing. We ask, Lord, your wisdom as they make decisions. We pray, O Lord, that those decisions will be for the best of all. We pray for our schools. We think of our teachers and administrators, support staff, school board, all seeking to meet the needs of raising our children. We pray that our schools would be havens of safety and of learning. We pray for our workplaces. We pray, Lord, that in the midst of some of those workplaces where there may be opportunities to share your love, that we will be bold enough to do so. We pray for some of our workplaces, Lord, that it may not always be a haven of peace. We pray for your presence. Be with us each and every day. Pour out your blessings. Touch us anew. Remind us who we are and whose we are. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today after worship, we will have Sunday school for all ages. We do remind you of the opportunity to hear more about the ministry of translation. This evening, we will have our kids club and youth group, as well as the Time, Treasure, and Talent. That's from 6:30 to 8 p.m. This evening, we will have Sue Keppen with us, and she will be sharing, I'm going blank on her, there it is, the role of community in mental health recovery. And so we encourage you to come and take part in this evening's programming. Don't forget that Tuesday is Election Day, and so you have an opportunity to vote. Sewing group will be meeting at 10 a.m. on Tuesday morning. The Vacation Bible School Work Night will be held on Tuesday evening from 6 to 8 p.m. We've got Adult Bible Study going on Wednesday at 10:30 in the morning, and then in the evening at 7 p.m. And want to remind you that I will be leaving on Monday, driving down to North Carolina for the United Methodist General Conference. That's a two-week event, and I'll be down there for that time. And then Lois and I will be going down to Orlando, Florida the week following for the Boy Scout annual meeting. So Dave Wilson will be taking care of pastoral care during this time. He'll also be here to share and worship with you the next two Sundays. All right, before we jump there, also want to remind you of our prayer card for Vacation Bible School. As we prepare for VBS, we've been giving you a card each week. We encourage you to tuck that into your daily devotionals, that you might offer prayer this week for the volunteers. Also, on Saturday, May 4th, there is a Women's May Fellowship Luncheon that will be held at Oak Grove Lutheran Church, and that's at noon. If you are interested in going, let Sue Ann know, and she'll take care of getting your reservations all in. That's on Saturday, May 4th, so she'll need to know by next Sunday. Thank you for the many ways in which you have taken part in supporting the ministries of the church. We, our gifts of the offering plate help to support not only what happens here in our building, but also supports missionaries. It supports our part of the mission and ministry of the United Methodist Church. And we have the opportunity to share the love of God because of your gifts, not only of the plate, but also of your time and your talent. And so we thank you for those many ways in which you seek to make a difference. I do want to share with you that on Friday, we closed on the sale of Freedom property. And so it is now going to become Freedom Place, a ministry of Skywalker Ministries. There'll be more in the newsletter to tell you about that. But again, it's another great opportunity that we get to be a blessing in the Skywalker Ministries work here in our community as they look forward to their next 20 years, just as we've been a part of it for the last 20 years. Let's go to the Lord as we raise our voices together and sing in our doxology this morning. Join with me in our statement of faith. We believe in one God, creator and sustainer of all things, father of all nations, the source of all goodness and beauty, all truth and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher, example, and redeemer, the savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, for comfort, and for strength. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, the life of love and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the Word of God contained in the Old and New Testaments as the sufficient rule both of faith and of practice. We believe in the Church, those who are united in the living Lord for the purpose of worship and service. We believe in the reign of God as the divine will realized in human society and in the family of God, where we are all brothers and sisters. We believe in the final triumph of righteousness and in the life everlasting. Amen. Let us lift our voices together as we join in singing Crown Him with Many Crowns. Indeed, we give thanks for all the messengers across time that help to bring God's word alive for us, be it through language translation, through proclamation, through teaching. We give thanks for those who have led us in our journey of faith. Go forth now and take that opportunity then to share the love of God with others that you meet, that they too may come to know Jesus. In the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, go forth now. Amen.